Hello, and welcome to our basic R course focused on differential analysis of quantitative proteomics data using R. Your trainers are Karin Schork and Michael Turovic. This video deals with the very first steps in R. These steps include the software RStudio, data types, basic operators, and functions. This is an absolute beginner R course. And we are going to start from scratch. So the first topic we want to discuss is, what is R? R is a programming language and a free software environment for statistical computing and graphics. When you install R on your computer, there will be a program named R on it. And when you start this program, it will open a programming console waiting for your commands. But we will skip this in this course. In this course, we will use only the software RStudio, which uses your R installation within a graphical user interface. R is available as free software under the terms of the Free Software Foundation's General Public License, so you can use it for free. R is an improvement as well as a free and open source alternative to S and S+, a predecessor language created at Bell Labs in 1976. R was published by Ross Ihaka and Robert Gentleman in 1993. Since R is open source, there is a very active development of R extension software libraries, the so-called R packages. Especially for bioinformatics, there are many very useful and high-quality packages for biological data available. So today, R is together with Python, the most popular language for data analysis. When you want to start with R, you will find all the things that you need when you go to these links. Among others, you will find the R sources and binaries for different operating systems there. You will find also R packages with diverse methods for bioinformatics, statistics, and many more. And of course, you will also find online manuals, FAQs, documentation, and support there. In this course, we use the software RStudio to work with R. After starting RStudio, you should see something like this, the main window of the RStudio software. As you can see, RStudio's main window is subdivided into four sub-windows. In the bottom left sub-window, you see the so-called R console. So always, when we mention the term R console, or briefly console in this course, we refer to this sub-window in RStudio. This sub-window shows a similar R console as when you would start the program R directly. After starting RStudio, the console shows some general information. This includes information on the installed R version, which commands will start the help functions, how to get license information, and how the R console can be terminated properly. Always, when you see this greater than sign in your console, then R is ready to take your commands. Then you can type a command into the console and press the return button to execute it. If you type some nonsense, then of course an error will be reported in the console. Regarding the other sub-windows of RStudio, we will use mainly the upper left and the bottom right sub-windows in this course. In the bottom right sub-window, a specific output of your commands is shown. This may be, for example, a plot. In the upper left sub-window, you have a text editor. Especially for more complex analyses, it is advisable to use an editor to prepare the code before pasting it to R. This provides transparency, reproducibility, and transferability to other datasets. Of course, RStudio is not the only software available for free to work with R. Another very good software is TinR. But currently, RStudio is the most popular software that provides a good R text editor and where you can work with R very well. As already mentioned, in the upper left subwindow of RStudio, you have RStudio's text editor. Here you can write multiple R commands, one after another, and one command per line. This sequence of commands is the so-called R code. You can save your R code as a so-called R script into a file. R scripts are more or less small R programs that can be executed completely or partly in RStudio. This is very useful to store and recycle R code. Thus, we recommend that you store your working R commands in an R script during this course, especially for solving the exercises of the hands-on sessions. Another useful feature is that you can mark parts of your code in the editor and execute it via the run button in the console. Now we want to learn our first commands. And the most basic usage of R is to use it as a pocket calculator. Here are some examples of the arithmetic operations that we can perform with R. This includes, of course, the basic operations addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division of integers. Besides integer numbers, also decimal numbers can be used. Before we test these examples in RStudio, please note that, of course, the basic calculation rules that you have learned in school are also valid in R. So, multiplication and division are always executed before addition and subtraction. To change this, you have to set brackets. One general remark: when you see a plus sign instead of the greater than sign at the beginning of a line, then the command that you have entered is not complete. And now, let's test these things in RStudio. So here is our RStudio main window. And in the bottom left subwindow, we have our console. And here we can enter 1 plus 3, press the Enter button, and then we will return the correct result into the console. This is, of course, 4. But as already mentioned in the slides, we can also go to the text editor, and here R code has been already loaded from a R script file, and here we can mark the corresponding line, press on the run button, and also with this the correct result is returned by R. When we go to the next line, then we see that the computation 6 divided by 2 is entered here, and a command. A command starts always with a hashtag, and everything that is coming after the hashtag is the command. And everything that is coming after this hashtag is not executed. So when we try to execute the complete line, we see that only the computation is correctly executed and the command not. So you can use this to comment your code, or like this, or you can even do things like this. This is very useful to make your code more visible. In the next two lines, we have these very similar computations that demonstrate us the basic calculation rule that always first the multiplication is executed. So we have here 6, and then of course the result is 1. And if we want to change this, we have to set brackets, and then first the subtraction is executed, and then the result is 8 in this case. Then we can also divide 0 by infinity, and the result of this is 0. This here will not work, because dividing 0 or even any number by 0 is not defined. And in these cases, R returns us NAN, and this stands for not a number. As already mentioned, we can also use decimal numbers for our computations. And with this here, we will get the quadratic value of 3, and this is of course 9. Here we can use the square root function to compute the square root of 9, and this is of course 3. And if in this case we would have forgotten to close the brackets, then this command would be not complete, and then, as already mentioned, the plus symbol will occur, and we can fix this quickly by closing the brackets, and then we will get the correct result. And with 12 and 144, this also works. Let's go back to our slides. The next topic are assignments. Now we will learn how to save numbers and results of your computations in so-called objects. Objects are similar to variables that you know from school. For example, you can assign the result of the computation 3 plus 5 in an object called asum. For this assignment, the arrow operator is used. So now this object, in this object, the integer 8 should be stored. You can also assign only a single specific number, for example 4, to an object, for example called a number. With these objects, all computations can be performed like with numbers, and the results of such computations can be stored in objects again. Let's test this in RStudio. So here we want to assign 3 plus 5 to a sum, and when we call this object, then we see that the correct result 8 is stored here. Here a single number, and the number 4 is assigned to a number, and the correct number was stored in a number. Here we can perform a computation with these two objects, and the correct result of 8 plus 4 is returned. And when we divide the content of a sum, which is 8, by 2, then also the correct result of 4 is returned. We can also compute a difference, and now we can go back to our slides and discuss the naming of objects. The names of objects in R may contain letters, numbers, as well as the special characters period and underscore. They have to start with a letter, and they are always case sensitive. Today we will create many objects. R saves these objects in the so-called workspace. This is the working memory of R. With the function ls, you can list all currently active objects. In programming languages, functions are previously defined commands that perform a specific task or a specific computation. Functions are commands where the function name is followed by brackets. We have already used the square root function to compute a square root of a number specified in the brackets. This number was the so-called argument of that function. But let's go back to the objects in the workspace. To remove a single specified object, the rm function with the name of the object as argument can be used. To remove all currently defined objects in the workspace, the rm function with the list of all known objects as argument can be used. So with another argument, type of argument, the rm function shows another behavior. To end your session, the RStudio window can be closed or the function queue can be used. Then you will be asked whether the current workspace, including all objects, should be saved. Otherwise, all objects will be lost. Let's test these things in RStudio. Before we test the ls function, let's have a look into the upper right sub-window of RStudio. Here we see that all objects that we have defined so far are listed in this table, including their current values. So this sub-window gives us already a good view over the objects already defined. And when we use the ls function, all these objects are listed, and here we can also check whether the correct values are stored in these objects. And this is the case. And when we want to remove a number from the workspace, we use the rm function. And after that, when we try to call a number again, we get an error because a number is not available anymore and is also not listed here in the sub window. And then when we think that we are finished with our computations and when we want to close our R session by closing the RStudio window, we will be asked whether we want to save our workspace, including all currently active objects, in this file. But we don't want to do that now. We want to go back to our slides. Well, we have learned that for most useful tasks in R, we need functions. Now the question is, how do we know how to use them? For example, the rm function accepts various elements, and depending on these arguments, this function returns different results. Since there are thousands of functions in R, and each of them has another set of arguments, we need help. To this end, R provides so-called help pages. These are HTML sites which can be shown in a web browser or in the bottom right sub-window of RStudio. To start, the help system, the general overview page function help start is used. To show all help pages containing a specific keyword, the function help search with the keyword set in quotes as argument can be used. There is an alternative command, two question marks before the keyword set in quotes. And if you know the exact name of the function for which you need help, then you can call its help page directly via the function help with the name of the function as argument. The alternative command for that is one question mark followed by the exact function name. Let's test this in RStudio. So, for example, when we want to start the general help page, then we enter help start and we see here the general help page of your R installation, for example, giving you a list of all the R packages that you have currently installed. If you need a function that is associated with the t-test, then you could search for this keyword and then you will receive a list of help pages where the t-test is mentioned somehow. This here is the alternative command, and again you get the list of associated help pages. And if you would forget the quotes, then an error would occur. So the quotes are needed for this command. So, and when you know that there is a t-test function in R, then you could search directly for this function by typing, for example, this. But oh no, the name was not correct. So this page was not found. So you have for this always to use the exact name of the function to get the respective help page. And the alternative command for that was to type help. And you get also the respective help page. Let's go back to our slides. Here again, the help page for the function t-test is shown. And all help pages have a specific structure with the following sections. In the description section, a brief description of the function and what it does is given. In usage, the function with ordered arguments and their default values is shown. Arguments gives you a list and a description of the arguments or parameters of the function. In details, a detailed description of the function is given. Value describes the output of the function. And see also, links to similar or associated functions are given. And also very important is the section examples. Here some basic examples are shown how this function can be used. It is always a good idea to check the help pages of a function before you use it. Usually, most questions about a function can be answered by carefully reading the help pages. The next topic are basic operators, functions, and specific values. Here, the basic arithmetic operators we have already used for the pocket calculator are shown. The basic functions of R include, for example, functions that compute extreme values of a given set of numbers, max and min. There's also a function to compute the absolute value of a given number. And we have already used the square root function, which computes the square root for a given number. There are also three functions for rounding numbers. You can round numbers commercially, or you can round a decimal number down or up to the next integer value. There are trigonometrical functions which compute the sine, the cosine, and the tangent. And of course, there are also functions that compute logarithms for given bases, for example, the log 10 or log 2. Or you can use the general log function. Here you can specify the base by an argument. And with exp, the exponential function is available in R. Other functions, sum and prod, will compute sums and products of given sets of numbers. A very useful function in R is length. It returns the number of elements in sets of elements, for example, vectors. Length will be very useful for the exercises in the hands-on session. Let's test some of these functions in RStudio. So the absolute value of 5 is, of course, of minus 5 is, of course, 5, as well as for 5. You can round a decimal number to a length, specified length, which is specified by an argument. You can also round it with floor to 3, to round it down to 3, or with C-Link to round it up to 4. Well, and the logarithm to the base is 10 of 1 million is of course 6. And when you have, for example, a collection of numbers, like a vector, then you can use the length function to get the length of this collection of numbers. Here we have 4 numbers, so the length of that is 4. Let's go back to our slides. And here, some specific outcome values of your computations are shown. As we have already seen, some computations will return infinity. Infinity can be positive or negative. And computations with not defined results will give NaN. Sometimes you will find also missing values in your data or in your results, and missing values are symbolized by NA. And finally, there's also a empty set object available in R. This is the null object.